everyone, welcome. We have a special treat for you today. We're doing a factory tour. We are here at KGM Technologies with Kyle, the owner and founder of KGM Technologies. He is a longtime friend of Jesse and I's. We go way back to like the very beginning of Blue Alpha, kind of lines up pretty well with the very beginning of KGM.
Very, very close. When y'all were sewing in your garage, I was building building stuff in a pretty small shop.
So. Yeah, yeah. So we've been longtime friends, and we wanted to take you guys for a tour of this place because I've been here before, and it is definitely worth seeing. There's a lot of really advanced technology, cool testing, R&D stuff that is happening here. So let's get the tour started. All right, Kyle, so what room are we in right now?
So we're in the fun room. This is the R&D room. This is where we keep all of our test guns, test cans, all the kind of different derivations of weapon systems we use to validate cans, do development, do research. We have R&D projects in here. So we got everything from original belt-fed cans we use for testing, super lightweight prototypes, fun guns, all of our fun machine guns, weird old European stuff.
Yeah, I would
a little bit of everything.
I think this is past fun gun and well into meme gun territory.
Oh, 100%.
So this is the Sten P5. A long time ago, back in the day, this was one of the fun guns that me and Kyle would mess around with. It's a classic. It's an OG, that's for sure.
It's a hodgepodge of all kinds of things.
So R&D is a big part of KGM. We're going to see more of that coming up.
Yep.
But you guys put a lot of effort into knowing exactly what's happening and optimizing all of your products and everything that you do to get the best performance. And you're doing that in ways that is kind of very unseen or unheard of or extremely innovative, like leading edge ways that you're doing that, right?
Yeah, so we try to do it a little bit differently. We try to look outside the box. How are we going to test suppressors or develop suppressors in 1, 3, 5, 10 years? How is military and law enforcement requirements going to change? How is weapon systems going to change? So we try to think, I need to design the can now that'll be in the market in 2 years. So thinking about how things change and how priorities change. So in the last 5 years, military and law enforcement priority, even civilian priority of suppressors and what a suppressor is supposed to do has evolved. We've gone away a little bit away from, oh, it's just, you know, muzzle DB. That's the only thing we care about now too. What does it do to the host weapon system? Does it overrun your bolt? Does it make your bolt carrier dirty? Does it affect accuracy? Does it affect flash, thermal mitigation, all this other stuff? So the rules and the playground we're playing in has gotten exponentially bigger.
It's grown far past what does it sound like or how loud is it?
Yes. Now it's what is the tone and what is it, you know, how is it, like, it's not just a sound thing. There are five or six different other metrics you're looking at now of what a suppressor does to a weapon system. Yes.
And in order to know all that stuff, you are going to need a lot of testing.
A lot of testing, hence why we have so many test platforms, and then we'll go into the R&D lab and we'll show you how we test all these different metrics at a given time so that we're developing based on data, not based on just kind of how it feels. So we let the numbers tell us, we thought a design may be good, but we actually look at the numbers and be like, nope, that's not good. That's not good. So let's head in another direction. Yeah. And that's how we do R&D and how we do development, is we do it all based on numbers and what the data gives us. So we are a completely data-driven R&D team.
Nice. Let's go check out some of that R&D and let's see how they test some of these products to get them at peak performance. All right, Kyle, so based on all the foam on the wall here, that we're obviously in your recording studio where you lay down your latest hot tracks.
The sickest beats.
Sickest beats.
Yeah.
Or this is where you do some of your sound testing.
So this is essentially our shooting lab. What we did was we went to a lot of different military installations and testing facilities, and we tried to see how everyone tests and realized we wanted to be able to test everything at one time. So we came back and essentially designed our own system that allows us to test sound, kinematics, recoil, flash, everything at one time, and then we control it with a PLC that allows us to do data analogs and graphs and everything like that, so we can really see what the suppressor is doing to a weapon system at the same time.
And like, that's like a really big deal. That's pretty dramatically different than what's been done historically with suppressors as far as the level and intricacy of the testing that you're doing.
Yes. So we test with a B&K pulse system, so it's a mil standard pulse system, so there's not the single mic at the muzzle kind of, which has been the previous kind of test method.
Right.
So we're testing environmental now. So it's muzzle, shooter's head, everything around the weapon system and shooting suppress, that's what we measure. So we measure, like, you know, in the recoil, we measure linear recoil as well as three axis. So what happens to the gun? Does it recoil in line? Does it pull up to the right? All that kind of stuff like that. We measure gas with a gas box. We measure flash. We measure all these other metrics that, again, allow us to evaluate a suppressor on a weapon system as a whole, as an environmental thing versus just a single point of measurement.
Right. And you can take a suppressor and make it best for a general use, but you can also custom tailor a suppressor to a specific use case scenario, a specific firearm, a specific barrel length,
specific ammo, everything.
Everything.
Yeah, so we do a lot of that, more of that on the mill side, where we'll say, we'll have a customer give us essentially a weapon system and ammunition and say, I need X, Y, and Z performance out of a suppressor given this weapon system. So while we do build stuff that has to span, you know, 5.56, we span from 7-inch barrel to 18-inch barrel.
Right.
So we have a can that'll do that. But then we also do very, very specific testing of, we want specific ammo, specific gun, specific gas system, barrel length. I want a tuned product for X.
Yeah.
So we're getting more and more where those requests are more than a standard request, where we have a lot of specialized product that we build for a customer that's more discerning.
Yeah, that's very cool. And having seen this stuff in action and tested some of this stuff, it's all really cool. And my inner nerd is very excited to see all this. I love, like, being able to gather all kinds of data and turn it into something that comes out with a better final product.
And allows us to always keep evolving, always keep learning. So as the more we test, the more we know about small arms, suppressing small arms, what happens when you change different things. It's all toggles, how you move the toggles to get what you need.
Right.
It's a learning thing. So we have mountains and mountains of data that we can pour through and actually start developing product based on data.
That's very cool. Well, I want to start seeing how these are made, so let's go check out some production.
Let's do it.
So Kyle, this is one of your main production rooms in here. What takes place in this room?
So everything comes from the cage, essentially gets washed, assembled, and then runs through laser welding, engraving, blasting, and paint. So this entire room, we can process all the product from a raw good all the way to something that can go into final assembly and packaging in this one room.
So tell me about laser welding. Like, why laser welding? What are the benefits? And, like, what do you guys use it
for? So laser welding, I was first introduced laser welding back in my power generation days, and we were actually using it for overlay. Laser is very good. It has its strengths and weaknesses like any welding process. But for what we do, laser welding imparts the least amount of heat into the part. So you can get a very straight product. You're not dumping a bunch of heat. It's very, very fast. It works great with, like, part stack up, which is kind of what mainly suppressors are, is you're stacking a bunch of parts up, and allows us to have very, very high production rates on a very small footprint.
Got it.
It's a very efficient process, and nothing actually touches the part. So reactive materials like titanium, it's very good because nothing actually touches the surface. You don't have to worry about contamination.
Got it.
So it's a very robust process for the kind of work we do. And I've got a long history in it, so when we were scaling all this up, I knew that's where we wanted to go. Okay. We kind of get away from TIG, move into laser, and now that's all we run is laser.
So you take a stack of baffles, and you squish them all together, and then use the rotary laser welder.
Laser beams.
Laser beams to turn it into one complete
homogeneous piece, yes.
Got it.
Lasers are very, so to give you an example, like TIG, you're welding at 6 to 7 inches a minute surface speed. We weld at 60 plus inches a minute.
That's a big difference.
So when you talk about cycle times and throughput and the production level that we're at, you have to look at processes like that are kind of non-traditional.
Cool. Yeah. Now let's talk about paint, the paint area. What do you guys usually coat your suppressors with, and why do you?
Cerakote, we do everything with Cerakote.
Okay.
It's kind of a lot of the industry standard, but it's also the requirement for a lot of the mill and international stuff we work on. So we do all of our own Cerakote blasting prep and everything in-house. We do a multitude of all the colors, everything like that. But we do everything in-house from parts to packaging.
All right. Well, it's definitely a very impressive room.
Thank you.
It was really fun to watch stuff get made in here. This place is really cool. All right, Kyle, we are in another room. There's some sort of high-tech wizardry happening behind us.
Yeah.
Can you explain what this crazy machine is and what it does?
So as we were ramping up production, we were sending a lot of parts out for coding, post-processing, stuff like that. We kept having issues. Vendor issues. I mean, I'm sure y'all have dealt with them on secondary suppliers. And we got to the point where we knew that we wanted to bring some of this technology in-house and kind of evolve our manufacturing, vertically integrate. So nitriding is a big thing of what we do in the firearms industry, but standard salt bath and stuff like that is just not something we wanted to keep moving forward with. It has a lot of limitations, so we moved into gas phase nitriding. So we bought some equipment out of Europe and essentially have scaled this as a completely separate side of the company. So while we do firearms parts, we also do everything from mounts, knife parts, putter heads, gear parts for automobiles, stuff like that. So it's a very, very separate part of the business, but also it kind of aligns with everything we're doing as well, and allows us to do some really good additive kind of technology to our existing suppressor line while having the in-house capability.
So it's just another way to vertically integrate and have more control over these processes.
Yeah.
You said it's gas phase nitriding.
It's gas phase nitriding. So it's a, you know, salt bath nitriding is done in a liquid of molten salt. This is done gas phase, which allows us a lot more freedom in how we organize parts, how we fixture stuff. I can harden the inside of complex assemblies. Like, I can harden chain links that are already assembled.
Oh, cool.
And so it allows us a lot more freedom when you get into slides and barrels and stuff like that. You want to actually harden the inside of the rifling. You need a different kind of process to kind of push the limits.
So this is the next generation of nitriding, basically.
It is.
Very
yes.
cool. Yeah, this stuff all looks fantastic.
Yeah.
These look great.
And allows us to, again, be a little more, you know, future looking in terms of how we process product and how we add value to our existing product line.
All right, very cool. So Kyle, what happens in this room full of packaging?
This is kind of the end of the line. You know, we talk about, we do a lot of OEM work for other people. So we do a lot of parts all the way to finished cans, to end of boxes, to packaging, to fulfillment. We have a whole different side of our business model that's just OEM. So this is where a lot of the kind of the end of the line for products are, and it either goes out to the customer or goes into fulfillment or anything like that. But this is where we handle all the final inspection, all the last QCs before it goes in the box, before it went out to a customer.
Got it. So that's one thing that is pretty unique about you guys, is being able to control the process from raw goods all the way until final packaging. That is something that is not super common in the suppressor world.
You see in a lot of other industries,
right,
like in terms of like a true OEM or order fulfillment, but yeah, we have a lot of stuff where we can control every part of the process all the way to fulfillment to customers on the OEM side. And then we can also just be a regular OEM where we just build it and ship it out to back to the original manufacturer. So we're kind of a hybrid step like that. Like I said, we see it in other industries. We didn't see it a lot in the suppressor industry. And you see it sometimes in firearms where you get OEMs make ARs, but in the suppressor industry, we really didn't see a lot of that. So we kind of scaled and built our business model so we can have multiple different kind of streams of revenue.
All right, cool. All right, I'm going to go put some of these suppressors in my pocket. Kyle, thank you so much for the tour. Your facility is huge and fantastic.
Thank you.
I love seeing like the innovation and all the advanced technologies. You guys are definitely on the leading edge of things, and I really appreciate you showing us around.
Oh, thank you for coming up. Like I said, we've known each other a long time, so glad for you to see kind of where we're taking things and that allow other people to see in a little bit of what we do, that we're not just a manufacturer. We do so many other things.
Yeah. This place is super cool. Where can people find KGM? What's your website?
KGM-tech.com, KGM Technologies on Instagram. Find us.
Definitely check them out, and you can check us out at BlueAlphaBelts.com. Thank you guys so much for watching. We appreciate it.